Just to recap, we started with Bill's story, and remember that Bill's story is in essence a complete picture of the alcoholic from the moment he began to drink until the time that he got sober and began his career of trying to help other people and trying to put together some kind of a society or fellowship. And so this chapter one is of extreme importance to the newcomer, because it is a complete odyssey of one alcoholic from beginning to end. It also contains some absolutely marvelous things that we need to look at. For example, it gives us a heck of a nice insight into Bill's character. Bill was a power driver, egoist, self-centered in the extreme. His interest was in money and making money and becoming famous and having power. He didn't understand, as we've had to come to understand, that we don't gain power that way. Anything that he thought that he had that was indicia of power turned out to be just dust in his mouth. It never amounted to anything, and it's the first time a crisis came along, it all went away. And so we see him struggling to maintain some kind of at least the semblance of his old way of life. Remember, he had joined country clubs, and he had gotten a country club golf tan, and he was meeting with people who were talking in the millions of dollars. And it had become a big shot on Wall Street, where his prognostications and his advice about investments had become very important. And yet, then when the crash came in 1929, and all that stuff started going away. And at the same time, although Bill had been drinking very heavily, and the way he described it, about everybody was in those days, when he tried to pull himself together, he wasn't able to. So tonight we're going to continue looking at Bill as his disease progresses. Now that's another aspect of the first chapter, which is very important, because this is the first view that the newcomer will have of the progression of the disease of alcoholism. Now, as we've discussed in here before, when we get up to chapter 8, the chapter to wives, there is a full exposition of the progression of the disease in that chapter. But right up front here, the new person is able to identify and to see themselves as their disease progresses, they can watch as Bill's progresses. And so, Bill had gotten to a point now where alcohol was no longer a luxury, it was a necessity. A prohibition was on, and so he was reduced in many ways to drinking bathtub gin, the stuff that was homebrewed. Must have been real nasty stuff, but he was drinking a couple of bottles of that a day. And he was having terrible hangovers, and he had to get right into the gin in the morning in order to stop the shakes, in order to be able to begin to function. And he said this on page 5, the first full paragraph, 3 lines up from the bottom of that paragraph: "Nevertheless, I still thought I could control the situation. And there were periods of sobriety which renewed my wife's hope." And a lot of us know what he's talking about there. You know, I'd take the pledge and it might work for 3 or 4 days, or five, even 2 or 3 weeks. Going on, he says, "Gradually things got worse. The house was taken over by the mortgage holder. My mother-in-law died. My wife and father-in-law became ill. Then I got a promising business opportunity. Stocks were at the low point of 1932, and I had somehow formed a group to buy. I was to share generously in the profits. Then I went on a prodigious bender, and the chance vanished." I want to refer you back, because a lot of this stuff, of course, it keeps repeating itself. And Dr. Silkworth talked about this, remember, in his opinion. see. Okay, on bottom of page Roman 29, or if you have the third edition, Roman 27. The last partial paragraph. I do not hold with those who believe that alcoholism is entirely a problem of mental control. I've had many men who had, for example, worked a period of months on some problem or business deal which to be settled on a certain date favorably to them. They took a drink a day or so prior to the date, and then the phenomenon of craving at once became paramount to all other interests, so that the important appointment was not met. These men were not drinking to escape. They were drinking to overcome a craving beyond their mental control. If you go back to page 4 again, you'll see that this is exactly what happened to Bill. Page 5, I mean. He had a promising business opportunity. He was to share generously in the profits. Then I went on a prodigious bender and the chance vanished. I woke up. This had to be stopped. I saw I could not take so much as one drink. I was through forever. Before then, I had written lots of sweet promises, but my wife happily observed that this time I meant business. And so I did. Anybody here identify themselves with that? Shortly afterward, I came home drunk. There'd been no fight whatever. Where had been my high resolve? I simply didn't know. It hadn't even come to mind. Someone had pushed a drink my way and I'd taken it. Was I crazy? I began to wonder, for such an appalling lack of perspective seemed near being just that. Now let's go forward and we'll see again that this foreshadows what we're going to be reading back a little later. Let's go to the third chapter, page 41. Remember, this is the story of Fred now, the CPA, who was in Washington on business. He'd had a very successful day. Everything was wonderful. And he'd come back to his hotel, not a care in the world. First full paragraph. I went to my hotel and leisurely dressed for dinner. As I crossed the threshold of the dining room, the thought came to mind that it would be nice to have a couple of cocktails with dinner. That was all, nothing more. I ordered a cocktail in my meal, then I ordered another cocktail, and so on and so on. He ended up in a major drunk, went back to New York, and went around with a taxi cab for several days. Down at the bottom, page 41, last partial paragraph. As soon as I regained my ability to think, I went carefully over that evening in Washington. Not only had I been off guard, I'd made no fight whatever against the first drink. This time I had not thought of the consequences at all. I go to the top of page 42. He's telling us here what his friends in AA had told him. First line on top of page 42. They had said that though I did raise a defense, it would one day give way before some trivial reason for having a drink. Well, just that did happen and more, for what I had learned of alcoholism did not occur to me at all. I knew from that moment that I had an alcoholic mind. I saw that willpower and self-knowledge would not help in those strange mental blank spots. The strange mental blank spots. But now we see Bill in exactly the same situation. And he's now beginning to wonder if he's crazy. Of course, you and I know that when we came in the door, we were screwy, you know. Our minds weren't at all together. They weren't put together very well. Remember that on that score, we have to consider this business of insanity, especially when we get to the second step, because it talks about us being restored to sanity. Now, we're seeing here one form of insanity, that is the insanity of that first drink, the drink that we take without further thought or when our mind tells us that we can get away with it, even though we know the consequences. We've been there before. We may have a pretty strong fear of what could happen if we drink again, but nevertheless, we drink anyway. So Bill is demonstrating for us here just exactly how that was happening with him. We're back on page 5 now, down at the bottom of the page. Renewing my resolve, I tried again. Some time passed, and confidence began to be replaced by cocksureness. I could laugh at the gin mills. Now I had what it takes. One day I walked into a cafe to telephone. In no time, I was beating on the bar, asking myself how it happened. As the whiskey rose in my head, I told myself I would manage better next time, but I might as well get drunk, good and drunk then, and I did. Well, now, Bill raises an interesting question here. Think about it for a second. What he's saying is he'd gotten sober enough that he'd gotten cocky about it. But he didn't have anything backing him up. There was nothing backing up his sobriety except willpower. And we need to ask ourselves, does this cockiness, this cocksureness, does that go away? And the answer, yes, it does. Let's turn to page 85 and we'll see. Top of page 85. Go down 5 lines. Talking about alcohol now and the obsession compulsion to drink. We are not fighting it, neither are we avoiding temptation. We feel as though we've been placed in a position of neutrality, safe and protected. We have not even sworn up. What? Haven't sworn up? Holy cow. We never said, I'll never drink again. We didn't have to do that. Of course, the big book never says don't drink, does it? That would be ridiculous to tell somebody who can't not drink. Oh, by the way, just don't drink. We've not sworn off. Instead, the problem has been removed. It does not exist for us. We are neither cocky nor are we afraid. See what's happened here? By letting God come in and being restored to sanity, the cockiness has been taken away. But for Bill, it was the operative fact here of his going back on the sauce again. He got cocky about it. Going back now to page 6, please. First full paragraph. The remorse, horror, and hopelessness of the next morning are unforgettable. The courage to do battle was not there. My brain raced uncontrollably, and there was a terrible sense of impending calamity. I hardly dare cross the street, lest I collapse and be run down by an early morning truck, for it was scarcely daylight. An all-night place supplied me with a dozen glasses of ale. My writhing nerves were stilled at last. A morning paper told me the market had gone to hell again. Well, so had I. The market would recover, but I wouldn't. That was a hard thought. Should I kill myself? No, not now. Then a mental fog settled down. Gin would fix that. So 2 bottles and oblivion. Now this business of killing ourselves, you know, and drinking ourselves to death, Dr. Silkworth told us about that all the way back in his story. Let's go back to Dr. Silkworth's story, opinion just for a second. We need to take a look at that. In the 4th edition, it's Roman 28, and in the 3rd edition, Roman 26. Here's what he has to say. These allergic types can never safely use alcohol in any form at all. And once having formed the habit and found they cannot break it, once having lost their self-confidence and their reliance upon things human, their problems pile up upon them and become astonishingly difficult to solve. And then, let's go to page 30 now, or 28, right at the top of the page. The first full paragraph, just the 3 little lines there. There are many situations which arise out of the phenomenon of craving, which cause men to make the supreme sacrifice. rather than continue to fight. The supreme sacrifice here, of course, means death. And so we see Bill here toying with that idea, and it was, he just decided that he was not going to do it right now. Back on page 6 again, please. Sorry for all this bouncing around, but this is the way we need to study the big book, because, you know, it isn't all in one place. Things are scattered all the way through it. And when you study the book, you begin to see all these connections. And one of the things I'm trying to do with this meeting is to show you as many of these connections as I can. See, the big book is always consistent. It's never inconsistent. And many of the things which we need to know are in different places, and we need to see how they all pull together and tie together. Because once you do that, you see the full pattern and the full majesty of this book. It is an inspired document. And as Bill wrote it, as he was writing what he was inspired to write. As a result of that, you're going to find there are many places in this book which seem to be out of order. They seem to be in terms of an English lesson, non sequiturs. That means that they don't seem to apply to anything that surrounds them. And we find later on that what they were really doing was forecasting the future and showing us what was to come. Or we find that they weren't really out of place after all, because they tie into something that we're going to read a little bit further along. And so I'm going to try to point those things out as we go, because, you know, being able to read this book intelligently and understanding what we're reading is so critical, not only to us, but to the people we want to help. Now we're going back on page 6, the last partial paragraph. The mind and body are marvelous mechanisms, for mine endured this agony 2 more years. Sometimes I stole from my wife's slender purse when the morning terror and madness were on me. The word slender there, by the way, does not refer to the size of the purse. It refers to the amount of money in it. A slender purse is one that has very little money, but he was still stealing from her. And I swayed dizzily before an open window or the medicine cabinet where there was poison, cursing myself for a weakling. There were flights from city to country and back as my wife and I sought escape. In that one sentence, Bill is covering the whole phenomena of geographics, and many of us have experienced that. Then came the night when the physical and mental torture was so hellish I feared I would burst through my window sash and all. Somehow I managed to drag my mattress to a lower floor, lest I suddenly leap. A doctor came with a heavy sedative. Next day he found me drinking both gin and sedative. This combination soon landed me on the rocks. People feared for my sanity, so did I. I could eat little or nothing when drinking, and I was 40 pounds underweight. And you might be interested in the reference here to a sedative. Of course, he's talking about an addictive substance, but this is not the only time that the big book makes reference to that. If you go back to go forward to page 22. Sometimes I think we get overly sensitive about people including drugs in their alcoholism story. The big book does. Top of the page. If he can afford it, he may have liquor concealed all over his house. Page 22. To be certain no one gets his entire supply away from him to throw down the wastepipe. As matters grow worse, he begins to use a combination of high-powered sedative and liquor to quiet his nerves so he can go to work. Then comes the day when he simply cannot make it and gets drunk all over again. Perhaps he goes to a doctor who gives him morphine or some sedative with which to taper off. And he begins to appear in hospitals and sanitariums. And so there is a history right here in the big book of the combination of drugs and alcohol. And this is something that perhaps many people haven't seen, or maybe they haven't read the book very hard to find out that it's there. Okay, let's go on now. On top of page 7. My brother-in-law is a physician, and through his kindness and that of my mother, I was placed in a nationally known hospital for the mental and physical rehabilitation of alcoholics. Uh-huh. Now we see Bill doing what? This is his first visit to Towns Hospital, and his first opportunity to meet that good little doctor, Dr. Silkworth, who Bill later in this book credits as being one of the three principal influences on the formation of the program of Alcoholics Anonymous. William James, Dr. Silkworth, and the Oxford Group. Those are the three principal influences which Bill later cites. Now we see him going to, and just think about this for a second, there probably were a dozen places he could have gone. But he needed at that point to get to know Dr. Silkworth, because Dr. Silkworth was fated to have a pivotal role in the formation of Alcoholics Anonymous, and therefore in the fact that you and I are here sober tonight, because we have a program that by using it, we're able to have a solution to our alcoholism, when otherwise there would be no solution. So now we find Bill in Towns Hospital, going on page 7, under the so-called belladonna treatment, my brain cleared. And you know what belladonna is? It's a poison. A deadly poison. I think it comes from nightshade, doesn't it? Isn't it? Yeah. Belladonna. So they were poisoning these people to get them detoxed. Wonderful. Hydrotherapy, you know, it was hot baths, cold baths, I don't know what. Maybe they threw them in some kind of a deep pool and put the hose on them, who knows. Hydrotherapy and mild exercise helped much. Best of all, I met a kind doctor who explained that though certainly selfish and foolish, that was true of Bill, I had been seriously ill, bodily and mentally. Now, this is the first time that Bill's ever heard that. Nobody's ever told him before that he had a disease, that he was seriously ill. Now, I notice that he would have believed immediately seriously ill mentally, because he already thought he was crazy. But here is his doctor telling him that he's seriously ill bodily. This is the first time in the body of the big book, outside of Dr. Silkworth's opinion, where we begin to see the outlines here of the problem. A bodily illness as well as a mental illness. It relieved me somewhat to learn that in alcoholics, the will is amazingly weakened when it comes to combating liquor, though it often remains strong in other respects. My incredible behavior in the face of a desperate desire to stop was explained. Understanding myself now, I fared forth in high hope. Wait a second now. Understanding himself. Didn't we just read in the third chapter a few minutes ago in Fred's story that self-knowledge and willpower did not keep him sober? We have so many examples of that. I think we've talked about this in here before, but when Roland Hazard went to Switzerland to be treated by Dr. Carl Jung, he was there for a year, and Carl Jung taught him all about himself. When Roland came back to the United States, he knew everything about himself. He knew all of his emotions and his motivations and his history. He knew exactly why he drank. He knew all the stuff. He had great knowledge about himself. And he believed absolutely that he was cured, came back to the United States within a few months he was drunk. And finally, when he went back to see Dr. Young said, well, you're one of those chronic alcoholics that we can't help at all. And it became obvious that all the self-knowledge that Roland Hazard had so expensively accumulated was not anywhere near sufficient to keep him sober. And so this is what Dr. Silkworth has been trying to teach to Bill. My incredible behavior in face of desperate desire to stop is explained. Understanding myself now, I fared forth in high hope. For 3 or 4 months, the goose hung high. Anybody know what that means? That's an old saying. That really means that everything was great. You can imagine you're in a kitchen that has all the beams across it in England, about 1700s, and there are a couple of geese that are hanging there, being ready to be cooked. And you look at those geese, and you know you're going to eat for the next week. So the goose hung high. Everything was looking up. I went to town regularly and even made a little money. Surely this was the answer, self-knowledge. Uh-huh. But it was not. For the frightful day came when I drank once more. The curve of my declining moral and bodily health fell off like a ski jump. After a time, I returned to the hospital. Now he's back for his second time at Towns Hospital. This was the finish, the curtain, it seemed to me. My weary and despairing wife was informed that it would all end with heart failure during delirium treatments, or I would develop a wet brain, perhaps within a year. She would soon have to give me over to the undertaker or the asylum. Now, this sounds as if it may not have any great significance, but the truth is that what we just read here has great significance. And I'll tell you why. It was after this that when Ebby came to see Bill, and Bill was open to listening to Ebby, and Dr. Silkworth figured it out. He said, Bill, you were open to your friend Ebby because I had told you the extreme nature of the disease which you have, and I had explained to you that within a year you were going to be dead or incarcerated in an insane asylum if you didn't stop drinking. He said, I know that that's one of the things which made you open and willing to listen when you had the opportunity to recover. And that's when he said to Bill, when you go out and work with these people out there that you want to help, you got to tell them what's wrong with them. Don't mince words about it. Tell them this is a deadly, incurable, progressive illness, and that unless they're able to stop drinking, they will die of it. So they got to understand this. This will open up their minds. This will give you an opportunity to help them. And that's exactly what Bill did. When? The very next time he had a chance was with Dr. Bob in Akron. And it worked. See how important this is? Each of the things that we read in here is of importance. We need to understand how they all tie together. What Dr. Silkworth told Bill right here, translated into what Bill began to do as he went out after the first 6 months, began to work. And then, where do we find it next? We find it in chapter 7, Working with Others. It's right there. Just what happened here to Bill turns out to be the way that we are directed to work with a new person. Give him the bad news. He's been talking about the aggressive approach which scares people off, and and rightly so, because the whole trick here, if you want to call it a trick, is for us to share our experience and not to preach and not to rant and rave, and not to show aggressiveness, and not to show a closed-mindedness. Fortunately, it says, for such aggression in the name of spirituality isn't often seen nowadays. Yet this sorry and unusual episode can be turned to good account. We can ask ourselves whether, in the less obvious but nevertheless destructive forms, we are not more subject to fits of spiritual pride than we had supposed. If constantly worked at, I'm sure that no kind of self-survey could be more beneficial. Nothing could more surely increase our communication with each other and with God. Now, I read this to be a plea to you and me to inventory our own approach to others on the subject of spirituality. I'd like to suggest to you that the Big Book and the 12 steps are real clear on how this works if we do it right. First of all, we will tell the newcomer how we recovered, and it tells us to stress the spiritual freely. But this is our spiritual growth and our spiritual experience. Remember in Bill's story, Bill was told by Abby, all that's necessary is for you to form your own conception of God. There is no AA God. We don't ask you to memorize a catechism or pass a spiritual test of any kind or religious test. You're free to choose your own conception of God. But also, even though you are now an unbeliever, it's only necessary that you be willing to believe, and that's where it all starts. So this avoids, you see, all of the pitfalls of saying, if you don't believe as I believe, you will drink again. Well, that's not true. That's not true. What we talk about then is what we did. Here's what I did, and that's what the Big Book talks about. It tells us what they did, precisely what they did, to come to a spiritual awakening, because it's in the action. Everything in this program has to do with the actions we take. None of it has to do with memorizing some philosophy or some religious concept. It all has to do with taking action, seeking God. And so, we can ask ourselves whether, in less obvious but nevertheless destructive forms, we are not more subject to fits of spiritual pride than we had supposed. So, he's asking us to look to see how we act, what are our motives, and how do we approach the newcomer. Many years ago, a so-called unbeliever brought me to see this very clearly. He was an MD and a fine one. I met him and his wife Mary at the home of a friend in a Midwestern city. It was a purely social evening. Our fellowship of alcoholics was my sole topic, and I pretty much monopolized the conversation. Nevertheless, the doctor and his lady seemed truly interested, and he asked many questions. But one of them made me suspect that he was an agnostic, or maybe an atheist. This promptly triggered me, and I set out to convert him, then and there. Deadly serious, I actually bragged about my spectacular spiritual experience of the year before. The doctor mildly wondered if that experience might not be something other than I thought it was. This hit me hard, and I was downright rude. There had been no real provocation. The doctor was uniformly courteous, good-humored, and even respectful. Not a little wistfully, he said he often wished he had a firm faith, too, but plainly enough, I had convinced him of nothing. 3 years later, I revisited my Midwestern friend. Mary, the doctor's wife, came by for a call, and I learned that he had died the week before. Much affected, she began to speak of him. His was a noted Boston family. He'd been Harvard educated. A brilliant student, he might have gone on to fame in his profession. He could have enjoyed a wealthy practice and a social life among old friends. Instead, he insisted on being a company doctor in what was a strife-torn industrial town. When Mary had sometimes asked why they didn't go back to Boston, he would take her hand and say, "Maybe you're right, but I can't bring myself to leave. I think the people at the company really need me. Mary then recalled she had never known her husband to complain seriously about anything or to criticize anyone bitterly. Though he appeared to be perfectly well, the doctor showed slowed down in his last 5 years. When Mary prodded him to go out evenings and tried to get to the office on time, he always came up with a plausible and good-natured excuse. Not until his last illness did she know that all this while he'd carried about a heart condition that could have done him in at any moment. Except for a single doctor and his staff, no one had an inkling. When she reproached him about this, he simply said, "Well, I can see no good in causing people to worry about me, especially you, my dear." Now this was the story of a man of great spiritual worth. The hallmarks were plain to be seen: humor and patience, gentleness and courage, humility and dedication, unselfishness and love, a demonstration I might never come near to making myself. This was the man I had chided and patronized. This was the unbeliever I had presumed to instruct. Now let's look at these attributes that Bill cites here for this doctor. Humor, that's something we practice, isn't it? Patience, we are patient, we practice patience. Gentleness is something that we practice, something we do. Courage, we demonstrate courage. Humility, we act with humility rather than with pridefulness. Dedication, we are dedicated. We don't just think about it. It's not a state of mind. It's what we do. We act in a dedicated way. Unselfishness. We act with unselfishness. And love. Love is not a state of mind, by the way. Love is loving action, or it's nothing. Love which is not acted upon is exactly the same as faith. Faith without works is dead. Love without loving action is dead. And when we look at this, what do we find? We find this doctor demonstrating all of his affairs, all of those attributes that we would want to ascribe to someone who is spiritually fit. These are the attributes we would like to have for ourselves. But notice that each and every one of those had to do with the way the doctor conducted his life. And that's the key for us. This program is not about undisclosed states of mind. When we read in the 10th step, the love and tolerance of others is our code, that doesn't mean that we carry around some vague idea of being loving. It means that we act with love. It doesn't mean that we have an attitude of toleration. It means that we tolerate. We are tolerant. And so when we learn this, then we see that what we're learning through the steps is to constantly act upon these things which we ought to do, which in and of itself will always inevitably lead to a spiritual awakening. Mary told us this story more than 20 years ago. Then for the first time it burst in upon me how very dead faith can be when minus responsibility. Faith without responsibility is dead. The responsibility to carry that faith, to act upon it. The doctor had an unwavering belief in his ideals, but he also practiced humility, wisdom, and responsibility. Hence his superb demonstration. Down at the last paragraph, "Therefore, and I'll believe this with all my heart, faith is more than our greatest gift. Its sharing with others is our greatest responsibility. So may we of AA continually seek the wisdom and the willingness by which we may well fulfill that immense trust which the giver of all perfect gifts has placed in our hands." That's our article for tonight. And now we share with each other, like to share on faith or how we work in expressing our faith to others. or our spiritual feelings to others, or anything which is comparable to that, please do. And let's start out. Who would like to begin the discussion, please?
Well, my name is Tom. I'm an alcoholic.
Hey, Tom.
Hi, Tom.
And I'll tell you about the faith I had 3 years ago. I started recording Jim, and I thought he had an awesome message. And I went to another group and just put me down for it and said, you're believing nothing, you know. And I heard some bad things. I knew that the word was, I mean, Jim's message was really good. And I just had faith that it would help a lot of people. And it had. And I thought I could have listened to all those people that were down on me. And I kept faith. And I knew that it would help people. And I'm still doing it 3 years later.
Yeah, we got kicked out of the Pompano Beach room, didn't we, Tom?
Yeah.
You remember that old biddy that was in there? It was saying, well, you can't record anything. And so we said, okay, we're out of here. Thank you, Tom. Who's next?
I'm going to share something that was going on in my life right now. Okay, for a long time, I truly believed that I was supposed to be doing spiritual things. And right now, I'm in the process of selling a business that I have. I'm doing environmental work, and I believe it's in the best interest for the company to sell this business to another company that will grow it. I think it'll be the best thing for the employees. And I think that God has intentions for me to do things to help other people. And I believe that one day I'm supposed to open up a treatment center to help alcoholics and addicts. And the thing is, it's like when I feel like I'm doing what I'm supposed to be doing, I get ridiculed by a lot of people. And it makes it very difficult. Dealing with all the feelings that, nobody has trust or faith. But I know in my heart that I'm doing what I'm supposed to be doing. You know, the thing for me is selling this business is not a financial windfall for me. And I do know that I'm going to have to try to do some other things to generate some more money to even try to start a business. But I truly have faith that that will happen. You know, that I believe that when you're trying to do good things, the things that I think God wants me to do, He will make it all happen, and I know that for a fact. As long as I'm not, as long as my motives aren't self-seeking, you know, as long as my motives are that of trying to do good for others. And when I started the company that I had doing environmental work, I started it out as a business that would be good to the employees, so I would be fair to the employees. And the thing is, we were one of the few companies that survived economic downfall in the environmental industry. And I believe everything that happened that kept us going, it was, you know, as I look back, it was only God that made it successful. It wasn't anything I had to do. I mean, I showed up and did what I should, but it was definitely a higher power that made it all happen. And, I'm going to try to do the next right thing, see what happens later on.
Good. Thank you. I think Bill would call what you've just described as having the vision for your future. And I want to read you something he wrote about that. He says, vision is, I think, the ability to make good estimates, both for the immediate and for the more distant future. Some might feel this sort of striving to be a sort of heresy, because we AAs are constantly telling ourselves one day at a time. But that valued maxim really refers to our emotional lives. It means only that we are not to repine over the past nor wishfully fantasize or daydream about our future. As individuals, we shall surely suffer if we cast a whole job of planning for tomorrow on a kind of providence. God has endowed us human beings with considerable capability for foresight, and he evidently expects us to use it. Therefore, we must distinguish between wishful dreaming for a happy tomorrow, today's use of our powers of thoughtful estimate, an estimate of a kind which we trust will bring future progress rather than unforeseen woe. And I think there is a massive difference between a vision that we have as opposed to that which we try to force to happen or demand that it happen or expect to happen. Those expectations will kill us. But when we act upon that vision, it sets into action, brings all the forces into play, all the dynamics are there. And then as we go forward, things begin to open up for us. If your vision is to have a treatment center, you keep that vision firmly in front of you, and all the other people around you are utterly irrelevant. Irrelevant. They mean nothing. You keep your eye on your vision and you work toward it, and it'll be amazing what'll happen. And when we find that good is coming out of our actions, it's always wise to give God credit. Always wise. Because that's the truth of it. That's where credit belongs. You know, guys, It isn't a question of bragging or overstating anything when we say that we have a way. In 1935, there was no way. People didn't stay sober. The doctors couldn't do it for us. The churches didn't do it for us. Psychiatrists didn't do it for us. There was no hope. And since 1935, that way has grown and grown and grown, and it has proven itself now with literally millions of recoveries. This is no longer any kind of guesswork. It's a fact. This stuff works. The big problem is we have to be willing to do it. The Big Book makes it very clear. If he or she is to find God, the desire must come from within. And there isn't any way that we can open up their heads and pour that in. We can't force it to happen. It's got to happen for each of us individually. And when it does, and we really want to seek God and we really want recovery, then yes, we have the way. And John, it never fails. Never fails. Provided we do the work. And what happens is the failures, if you watch them, are either those who never tried, or those who gave up trying somewhere along the way. Or those who went all the way and then stopped going. Somewhere along the line, we fail. The program never fails us. That's the truth of it. Who's next now?
Spirituality haven't experienced the other end of it. living life where, like, I was talking about spirituality, but living in the bottom, this low bottom. I don't know if people have reached that low bottom. Because once you reach that low bottom, there's nothing left, and you don't talk anymore. You start doing the work. You start changing. You start living again. And there is no more room for talk, really, for me. If I'm not doing it, and I'm not living a spiritual life, I'm screwed. I'm literally screwed. I'll make all the wrong decisions, I'll take all the easy ways out, and I'll really embarrass myself when I'm doing it. So what I found when I came to this program was I found my morals again, and I did my fourth step, and I started to become aware of certain things, and I understand who I am now. I know what my standards are, I know what my ideals are. And now I have to live them, just like the doctor said. You know, I have to live without the doctor. And I agree with John sometimes, but I found that there are people who talk a lot about spirituality, the ones that talk more about spirituality are the